Hello, everyone. Welcome. Thank you for joining the cast today. My name is Brad from GenieCast, and this is Accelerating the Future of Autonomous Transportation with Larry Burns. It is 10 a.m. Central Time, and I'd now like to introduce you to Harry Clark, the moderator for today. Harry?
Hello, YPO. I'm Harry Clark of the YPO Gold Arizona Chapter and the Learning Officer of the Entrepreneur and Innovation Network. I'd like to welcome you to this global conference call during Innovation Week 2018, Accelerating the Future of Autonomous Vehicles with Larry Burns. This presentation will last approximately 1 hour, and there will be a Q&A session at the end of the call. During the presentation, please submit your questions via the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen. Please note that this call is being recorded, and the recording link will be shared within 72 hours. Now it's a pleasure for me to introduce Larry Burns. Larry is one of the highest rated speakers within YPO, and I've had the pleasure of meeting him and listening to him many times, and he never ceases to amaze his audience. He's a futurist in the field of mobility, and his vision reaches to nearly all business sectors. His client list is impressive, including Waymo, formerly known as Google Self-Driving Cars. Larry was also in academia at the University of Michigan and Columbia University. And he was vice president of research and development for General Motors and was responsible for creating a vision for the future of the automobile. He has a PhD in engineering from UC Berkeley and a master's from University of Michigan, Go Blue. Larry is also a frequent keynote speaker, and his second book will be published this August, called Autonomy, the Quest to Build the Driverless Car, and How It Will Reshape the World. I'm now happy to turn the call over to Larry Burns. Larry?
Thank you very much, Harry, and welcome, everyone. I'm really looking forward to sharing my thoughts with you. Let me pull up my slides quickly. So I'll be talking to you about what I call the new age of automobility. And what I want to start with is my classmate, Carl Benz, from 1886. 132 years ago, Carl was granted the first patent for a gasoline-powered automobile. It was a remarkable invention. And since 1886, we've seen a continual, gradual evolution of the roadway transportation system, which includes vehicles and parking and roads and traffic laws and energy supply and regulations. It's really improved over this time frame. Cars are more affordable, they're more useful, they're more comfortable, they're safer, cleaner, and more efficient. And they're providing a great deal of freedom to people around the world. In fact, there's over 1.2 billion cars and trucks worldwide. If you take all of those vehicles and park them end to end and wrap them around the planet, they'll go around 100 times. So you get a sense of the scale of what Benz's invention has led to. And it gives you the freedom to go where you want to, when you want to, traveling with the people that you want to travel with, carrying the things that you want to travel. And that freedom is valued highly by all of us who have the capabilities of owning and operating a vehicle. The concern, though, are the serious side effects tied to this system. From a safety standpoint, we have an epidemic in roadway fatalities worldwide at 1.3 million. We're 95% dependent on oil for our energy, and we know the ramifications of that in terms of higher and fluctuating prices, as well as geopolitical concerns, traffic delays, land use for parking, climate change concerns, and the aging and costly infrastructure. So when you look at these serious side effects and you bounce it against the freedom, you really have to ask yourself, is this system sustainable? What's so fascinating about Benz's invention is that if you were an archaeologist and you dug up a 1900 vintage vehicle and you dug up a 2000 vintage vehicle and you did a genetic analysis on those two cars, you'd come away saying they pretty much have the same DNA. They're mechanically driven with a combustion engine, oil-based fuel with mechanical and hydraulic controls. They're human operated. They operate on standalone devices for general purpose. And the business model has been one of vehicle as a product. What I mean by that is that in order to have a car, you typically go out and buy one and own one. What happened, though, in 2007 to 2012 is really both ironic, fascinating, and very important. So we've had this 132-year evolution, but during the dark years of the auto industry, and I certainly lived those up close and personal as one of the senior officers in General Motors, during those dark years, three really important seeds were planted. The first was autonomous vehicles. In 2007, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency conducted what was called the DARPA Urban Challenge. And that was to prove out autonomous vehicles for hopefully military applications. Following that race, Larry Page and Sergey Brin stepped up and created Google self-driving cars. The second key event were electric vehicles. In 2008, the Tesla Roadster came out, followed by the Model S in 2012, which certainly has taken all of us a much greater step closer to being excited about electric vehicles. And then finally, transportation as a service with Uber in 2009 and Lyft in 2012. Each of these individually was an important step forward. All three of them together really offered profound change. And what was interesting about the three of them is they all came from outside the auto industry, which I think is an important innovation message in and of itself. And they were driven by people who had a bone-deep understanding of digital technology. Within the auto industry, we have a lot of great leaders. Most of those people come from either a finance background or an engineering background, and engineering is biased primarily toward mechanical engineering. And here you have people with this strong background in digital technology, really, really deeply understanding of driving change. And they also have a passion for designing and delivering compelling experiences. Whereas in the auto industry, the passion is designing and delivering a great car to a dealership that will attract you to come in and buy it. So these are very different players from outside the industry. And what they've created is not just three individual independent initiatives, but when you put them all together, when you intersect them, you create what I call the new age of automobility. What I want to do today is help you understand what I mean by that. Give you a sense of the consumer and business opportunities that will result from this new age, and very importantly, help you better prepare for what's coming in the future. And then I'll try to extract some lessons learned related to innovation from having taken this journey. So let's start with this DARPA Urban Challenge. This vehicle here is a Chevrolet Tahoe. It was called Boss. General Motors sponsored Carnegie Mellon University in this race. It was in 2007 in Victorville, California. The Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency offered a $2 million prize to anyone who could create a vehicle that could go 60 miles in a city setting, no remote control, no one in the vehicle, obey traffic laws, and do that in less than 6 hours. So I figured the $2 million looked pretty attractive given GM's financial crisis. So we entered it by sponsoring Carnegie Mellon. But what was fascinating, 89 teams thought they could do this. This is 2007. Actually, it's 2005 and 6 when they put out the request for participants. 89 teams, 35 actually built vehicles. And those 35 vehicles had to pass a driver's training test just like the one you would take. And then 14 made it to the race day finals. Carnegie Mellon and GM, we had Stanford and Volkswagen. MIT was there, all of the big name schools. It was really an exciting event. And two of the spectators happened to be Larry Page and Sergey Brin. GM and Carnegie Mellon did win the race. We were excited about that, but the real winner was this technology. It really was a proof of concept that maybe sensors and maybe onboard processors and maybe mapping technology had progressed far enough in Moore's Law that we actually could have a car drive robotically. Certainly Larry Page and Sergey Brin believe this. And the vehicle in your upper left is a Toyota Prius. And what they did is they went out and brought in 15 of the young engineers that were competing in this race, not just from one team, but from several teams. Chris Urmson was one of those key people. He happened to be the program manager at Carnegie Mellon, so I knew Chris quite well. But they brought them in from the Stanford team and University of Michigan and elsewhere. And Sebastian Thrun was the person asked by Larry and Sergey to lead this initiative through Google X. And the challenge that they put out in front of the team was to accumulate 100,000 miles on public roads and also to complete 10 100-mile routes that Larry and Sergey themselves went out and laid out in the Bay Area and in the California area. These were clear stretch goals, another clear example of an innovation best practice. They were hard, but they were not impossible. And there was a big reward out there for the team if they could pull that off. I was brought in early January 2011 to advise this team, sort of as the experienced automotive executive, and I continue to do that today as a consultant. And they completed that challenge, and they came back, and Larry and Sergey said, "How hard is this really?" And they said, "It's really hard, but we think we can do it." Subsequently, Waymo has emerged. The vehicle on the upper right is called Firefly. It was developed by that team in order to learn how to do a car, and very importantly, in order to illustrate what the vision might be. That vehicle does not have a steering wheel. It doesn't have a brake pedal or accelerator pedal or instrument gauges. Subsequent to the learnings from Firefly, Waymo then acquired Chrysler Pacifica hybrids and began deploying them in learning opportunities in several cities, but most importantly, Chandler, Arizona. Another innovation lesson is fast, rapid learning cycles. You know, think big, start small, and learn fast. And that's what they've been doing. And they've learned to the point where they now, in the lower right corner, have placed an order for 20,000 Jaguar I-Pace electric vehicles. So you get a sense of how Waymo has gone at this. That's not the only thing going on here. Electric vehicles truly are reaching a tipping point. I believe we're going to see the industry tip in that direction by 2022. What do I mean by that specific wording? I think the major spending of capital and engineering by the auto companies will be significantly directed toward electric vehicles by 2022. When I led product planning at General Motors, I did that for about 8 or 9 years, from 1996 to 2004. We were spending $15 billion worldwide on capital and engineering to develop products for around the world. So when I start talking tipping point, it really means a company like GM would be directing a significant amount of their spending toward the new EV. And I want to emphasize, yes, part of the reason electric vehicles are emerging is because of our concerns about oil, our concerns about climate change, and the regulations that have been put in place to stimulate EVs. But what's been learned by the industry from doing EVs is they're just simpler to do. They don't have all that complex mechanical systems, transmissions, all those moving parts in the engine, exhaust systems, and basically have zero emissions, electric motors, and energy storage. It opens up really nice interior packaging opportunities. So the tipping is going to happen because of consumer value propositions and business reasons, not just because of regulatory pressure, which I think is an important lesson in innovation, is you've got to target these tipping points, not some forecast in year 2030 or 2040, but really when are the forces in place where businesses really start to tip in a new direction. The next building block is transportation as a service. And yes, most people think about autonomous vehicles in the context of Uber without a driver. That's what we would call a shared use autonomous vehicle. I want to emphasize though, transportation as a service really encompasses the movement of both people and goods. In fact, you could use the same vehicles for package delivery as you're using in a community to move people around and integrate that demand of the movement of the people and the movement of the packages. Shared use and personal use. Yes, you could share these, but you could also have one of your own. I don't think you would own it. You would probably lease it, but you're the dispatcher. When you arrive at work and it drops you off, the service knows where it should go and wait for you. And while it's waiting, you may want to dispatch it to go pick up your kids and take them to soccer practice. Think about that as a personal valet. Long haul and local trucking, and very importantly, the infrastructure. What I mean by that are the gasoline stations, the parking, the maintenance services, the car cleaning. That really is part of this transportation as a service, and that's going to change considerably because as a service model, these vehicles will likely be refueled out of depots not corner gasoline stations. And the infrastructure for parking won't necessarily have to be pay a premium to park next door so you walk a short distance, because that car will be smart enough to go to the optimal place to park itself. So there's a lot going on here with transportation as a service. Let's talk about the kinds of vehicles that could emerge from this type of future. 80% of the trips in the United States are 1- and 2-person trips, yet our cars tend to be designed for 4 to 6 people. The average speeds in U.S. cities are 20 to 30 miles an hour, yet our top speeds of cars are 100 to 120. 70% of the trips in the U.S. are less than 8 miles, but we insist on having a range for our vehicles of over 300 to 400 miles. We now have an opportunity to tailor design vehicles for the typical trips people make and get a lot of that over-engineering out of the product. And what you're seeing here on this screen are some examples of the kinds of concepts and thinking behind that tailored design. The other thing that's important to recognize is that these machines are going to be designed for the rider, whereas the industry over the 132 years I talked about earlier, they've been creating the ultimate driving machine. They focus on 0 to 60 acceleration, the feel when you're cornering, the driving dynamics, the gauges, the packaging of the driver. We want to pivot this to the ultimate riding machine. The end objective of these vehicles are such that when you get out of them from your ride, you feel better than when you got into them. Whether you feel better because you got some work done, or you feel better because you took a nap, or you feel better because you connected with your kids, whatever the reason might be, it's all about that ride experience. So another really important innovation lesson in all of this is you've got to focus on delivering these compelling experiences. Then you want to optimize this for cost per mile. Whereas in the auto industry, we focus on optimizing the vehicle design for sale through a dealer. When you optimize for cost per mile, what you find out is you want to have machines that last about 300,000 miles versus 150,000 with a conventional car. You'll use up these 300 miles in a transportation as a service business probably in 4 or 5 year time frame. It wants to be electric because the energy savings is really a good payback. So if you can save 5 to 10 cents a mile because you're electric versus gasoline, you multiply that by that 300,000, you're looking at $15,000 or $30,000 savings, which is way more than enough to cover the extra cost of being electric. And then you want it to be designed for easy maintenance to make sure you get that 300,000 mile life. And then finally, when you put all this together, what happens is you end up having far fewer parts and far less material. You don't have the driver controls. You have the simplicity of electric drive. You have it tailored. And that means not only will the down-road implications of autonomous vehicles impact people who have a profession called driver, it's going to impact people who are actually manufacturing the vehicles because it's going to be simpler to build. If you think about that historical business model, what's so interesting about it, it's been a business model for over a century focused on selling vehicles, selling gasoline, insurance, and financing. The downside of that is that this model has really assumed a lot of things about a consumer, about you, the buyer of the car, that may not be really pleasant things for you to have to do. So I want you to think as I read through this slide, do you really enjoy shopping for a car or financing a car or insuring a car? How many of you, when your car is approaching empty, say, hooray, I get to pull into a gas station and get out of my car in the rain and grab that dirty gasoline pump, stick that hose in my car and get gasoline on my shoes and look over my shoulder to make sure I'm safe while I'm doing it? How many of you like getting your car washed or having to take care of or take your car to get maintained or looking for a place to park? Now, I know a lot of you like to drive. I understand that. But do you really like to drive in traffic? So what's been going on here? The auto industry assumes you're willing to do all of these things and put $32,000 on the table, which is the median price of a car. And then what you do with your car is you leave it parked 95% of the time. So is that really something that's ripe for disruption? Certainly the transportation as a service business model suggests that it is. So really a big emphasis in my story today is the innovation that's taking place here isn't any one technology by itself. It's several technologies that are converging And it's not technology alone, it's technology and innovative business models. It's all of that that's really going to be driving this change. Transportation as a service sells miles, trips, and experiences. A very different approach. And what you end up being able to do is eliminate all of these negatives and focus on delivering compelling experiences in riding in the vehicle. It is truly a transformational opportunity. It's an opportunity where you're going to go from human-driven to autonomous vehicles, combustion power to electric, oil-based energy to diverse energy, vehicle as a product to transportation as a service, general purpose vehicles to tailored vehicles, attractive cars and trucks to compelling transportation experiences, the machine design for the driver to the machine design for the riders, and a focus on vehicle cost transitioning to an optimized cost per mile. That is a lot of things coming together simultaneously. It's not just one thing. All of these things can combine to bring about the transformation. And when you add it together, autonomous vehicles and electric vehicles and transportation as a service, you get better transportation experiences at radically lower consumer and societal costs. I want to help you understand those terms a bit more. What do I mean by better experiences? Safer. The traffic safety experts predict that autonomous vehicles will likely eliminate about 90% of the crashes. That's because 90% of today's crashes are due to human error. And 90% times the 1.2 million people worldwide dying on roads divided by 365 days is a 3,000 people a day. So if we can get this objective met one day sooner, we'll save 3,000 lives. More convenient. Think about always being picked up at your door and being dropped off at the door versus having to walk out to your car somewhere and driving it and finding a place to park and then having to walk into your location. Think about being using your time during your ride exactly as you would like. I was convinced when I was leading research at General Motors that driving was the distraction. Why else would someone send a text in a machine that weighs 4,000 pounds going 70 miles an hour unless they thought it was more important to do that than to drive safely? So let's give people their time back, more personalized, more affordable, as I'll show in a second. All of this can be done simultaneously. From a cost per mile standpoint, Harry mentioned that I was at Columbia University for a few years. While I was there, I led a program on sustainable mobility. And we were very interested in how much does it cost today per mile to own and operate a conventional car? And how might that change if we had driverless vehicles that were shared with tailored designs? So the bar on the left, the blue piece is out-of-pocket costs, your cash that you spend per mile. It's depreciation, financing, energy, insurance, maintenance, those kinds of things. Parking, that's 75 cents a mile. The red bar is your time value. If you're a minimum wage person at $7.50 an hour and you move at 30 miles an hour, that means your time during that trip is 25 cents a mile. If you're a median income person at $25 an hour, moving at 30 miles an hour, you're at about 83 cents. So you add all that up and you're looking at $1.60 a mile. It's hard to believe. We don't think in those terms, but that's what you're paying per mile to own and operate a typical car. And when we studied a whole bunch of different communities, Ann Arbor, Austin, Rochester, New York, Salt Lake City, Sacramento, those kinds of places, Manhattan, Palm Beach County, Florida, over and over again, we convinced ourselves that we could take that down to 25 cents. Americans drive 3 trillion miles a year. This suggests there's $2 to $4 trillion per year ripe for disruption. So no wonder companies like Google or Apple or others became interested in this. There's not many sectors that could create that much shareholder value by going out and disrupting it. And keep in mind, these are the same companies that have leaders with a bone-deep understanding of digital technology and a belief that this is all possible. Lower societal costs, when you put all this together, we're able to address those fatalities and injuries. We can get to diverse energy sources. We can get to zero emissions. We can eliminate the need for a lot of the parking and improve traffic flow considerably. We can get much better land use. There's 3 to 4 parking spots per car in most of the urban areas throughout the world, and we can get much more equitable access. All of those things simultaneously. Is it an attractive business? So remember, I told you the optimal life of this vehicle wants to be about 300,000 miles. And if I can make just 10 cents out of that $1.60 down to 25, just 10 cents profit out of that change, I can make $30,000 profit per vehicle. Today's auto industry makes about $1,000 to $5,000. Actually, they average about $1,500 of profit per vehicle produced. Imagine that, and those cars last about 150,000 miles. Today's auto companies are making a penny a mile. Unbelievable. So this is a hugely more attractive place to be playing as from a business standpoint than the traditional auto manufacturers. Think about this a different way. If I could get a 10% share of those 3 trillion miles and make that 10 cents per mile, it's $30 billion of profit per year. That's Apple-like and Berkshire Hathaway-like profit. It's ExxonMobil profit in good years. So again, a very attractive business opportunity. And it's not just moving people. This slide highlights that Mercedes and Freightliner and Tesla, Waymo, Peloton Technology, Nikola is another one of these companies doing it with hydrogen fuel cells. All of these companies have become very interested in autonomous over-the-road trucking. Why? First of all, it's safer. About 3,000 to 4,000 of the lives a year lost in the U.S. on roadways are tied to over-the-road trucking crashes, and autonomous trucks will prove to be much safer. It's much lower cost. About $1.60 a mile is what it costs to own and operate these big rigs. 64 cents of that, about 40%, is driver wage and benefits. Fuel is the next biggest slice, and then you get to your utilization of your capital with the truck and trailer. All of these cost components, except perhaps you might be paying some tolls, will go down. And my farmer's math suggests we can reduce that by about 50%. At 300 billion miles a year and a 50% cost reduction, we're looking at $240 billion a year savings potential. And it doesn't stop there. The parts you can remove from that tractor actually are going to end up costing more than the parts that you're going to add to make it autonomous. Think about all the parts in the tractor on the left that are there because it's driven by a human. The doors, the seats, the windshield, the mirrors, the air conditioner, the steering wheel, the shifter, the pedals. It's a long list, cages. And you're adding sensors and processors and redundant controllers and software and maps. But again, my calculations suggest at maturity, it's going to save money, not cost money, in order to make the tractor autonomous. Look at this platform that General Motors released this year. It's one that they developed working with the military. It's called Cirrus. What a fascinating idea. It's electrically driven. It has both fuel cells and batteries in that skateboard-like flat chassis. It's going to lead to lower cost for some of the reasons I mentioned before, certainly cleaner power and more diverse energy. But also what's so interesting about this is what it means to the throughput of the whole trucking system. If you've ever been to the ports of Long Beach in LA, and I did a project there about 4 years ago, you realize how many times those sea containers get handled before the products inside the container actually get on the shelf at a Walmart or a Target store. Imagine taking that sea container off the ship, having packed that sea container for a specific Walmart destination, putting it on this flatbed, which is autonomous, and sending it on its way on a 24/7 journey to its destination. Pretty profound in terms of how you impact the entire logistics system. And the fact is, these autonomous vehicles can operate all day while truckers are constrained to 11 hours of operations per day. So you're going to double the range per day that you can cover, which is a quadrupling of the area that you can cover in a day, which is a really big deal for e-commerce because autonomous driving lowers the shipment scale economies and gets you things faster. And that's exactly what e-commerce is demanding of the trucking industry. And you know, it's not just over-the-road trucks. This slide shows several different players: Starship Technologies, Domino's Pizza, Starsky Robotics. Actually, Starsky is a virtual driver. They can sit in their headquarters office and control a truck 500 miles away, much like a military pilot might control a autonomous drone. And then Nuro, this company here in the middle, that was created by a couple of the original members of the Google self-driving team. And it's been tailored designed for a small package delivery in communities, including refrigerated products. So a lot of innovation going on in trucking. So this new age of automobility really does eliminate the negatives of automobile transportation. Hopefully I've got you convinced of that. It enables really compelling mobility experiences. Hopefully I convinced you of that. It promises a sustainable future, and I believe presents a very attractive business opportunity. And as a result, the new age of automobility will transform how people and goods move around and interact. A huge transformation. So that 132-year evolution, in my mind, is now going to enter into a major transformation to this new age. And it's not just the car companies. It's the freight companies, the energy companies, the finance companies, the insurance companies, retailers, people who provide transportation infrastructure, the transportation service suppliers, and real estate. All of these industries will be disrupted by the change that I've talked about. When? I'm sure that's on your mind, and I know you can't raise your hands on the webinar, but I want you to all think, how many of you really think this is something that you need to be worrying about in a 2030 timeframe? I'm sure some of you see it that way. What about 2025? What about 2020? How many see it as a right now thing? Something that you really need to be focused on today? And I want to help answer that question first by sharing what John Krafcik, the Waymo CEO, has been saying publicly. Our ultimate goal is to provide a self-driving vehicle tailored to every trip and to every purpose. We can do this because we're building the driver. This same driver can be adapted for all kinds of vehicles. What John is saying here is he's not going to be the vehicle manufacturer, Waymo. That's not what Waymo does. Waymo wants to be your driver. They want to be everybody's chauffeur, whether it's a small vehicle or a big vehicle, a suburban vehicle or a city vehicle. They're creating the world's best driver. They have driverless service operating in Arizona. They have been operating vehicles in Chandler with nobody in the vehicle. They purchased 20,000 Jaguar I-Paces that are electric vehicles. They have been talking about, or they've been demonstrating driverless over-the-road truck testing in Georgia. And a collaboration has been discussed with Honda on tailored vehicle design. So Waymo really is signaling this is a right now kind of a thing. This is me talking now. This is my perspective. I mentioned that I'm an advisor of Waymo, but I certainly can't talk on behalf of them. But on behalf of myself, having been in this area for some time, I really think that the enabling technology, the customer value, the business opportunity, and its scalability all could be proven within 3 years, all of it proven. And if that's the case, then the impact of businesses, if it has been proven, need to be preparing now for this likely tipping point, because this is going to be that magical moment where suddenly the world wakes up and the money spent on transportation is going to flow to this new age of automobility, not to the 132-year-old age of the automobile. So I think we're getting close to reaching this tipping point. So what do you do about it? How do you prepare for the new age of automobility? What should you be doing? And, you know, I've advised about 50 companies since I left General Motors. It's really been a pleasure to have an opportunity to do that. And I'm sure, like many of you who are online today, you realize there's no singular perfect company. Every company has a challenge. It's a really hard thing to be a perfect company. There's a lot of good companies doing a lot of good things. And I, because my career was an R&D career, and I've really had a chance to focus more out there on the future, I've been able to extract some innovation lessons and some business lessons from what I'm seeing. And what I'm going to share here are what I would call necessary things for you to do. They aren't sufficient. You're going to have to do more than this. But I think these things, if you're not doing them, I think you're going to be kind of at risk of being left behind. So let me sort of begin to wrap up with this in mind. First, you need to deeply understand what is possible. I think this is just a critically important reason why companies need to have advanced technology or R&D organizations. You need to have people working in the world of what's possible. You can't understand this deeply by listening to my webinar. You can't understand it by going to a conference. You can't understand it by reading journal articles. That's all too late. You can really only understand it by having a seat at the table with the people who are creating the new technology or the new business models and understand the new opportunities and threats that emerge from that. So yes, there's a lot of pressure for quarterly earnings, and yes, it's always attractive to say, well, one way to meet my numbers is to cut my future spending. I gotta emphasize, don't get caught short on knowledge. It's really important. You especially need that knowledge in digital technology and customer experiences. It's just gonna drive everything that we're doing out here. Listen to this quote, and Harry was kind enough to share this with me a couple weeks ago. You may have talked about it this week already, Harry, but it's from the CEO, Intel. Data will redefine how we experience life in our work, at home, and school, and even how we enjoy sports and entertainment. Data is going to make possible experiences that no one has even started to imagine. And it's not an exaggeration to say that the rise of autonomous cars will be the most ambitious data project we'll see in our lifetimes. This is a really profound statement because it ties what I said in that previous slide, digital technology and customer experiences together in the context of innovation. It's right at the heart of that. And the differentiators of know-how in the new age of automobility will be customer experience design, that ultimate riding experience. What are all the ways of doing enhanced mobility experiences? It's exciting for a lot of people. It's a whole new canvas to innovate on. At the same time, you can't ignore the fundamental blocking and tackling of delivering transportation services. Transportation is what I call a very stochastic world. It has randomness that changes with time. That's a tough world to operate in, whether it's a traffic accident, bad weather, a special event, you name it, you're going to have to deal with it with your operations. So fundamentals of operations are important. And then here is listed all of the technology that really is surfacing to be true differentiators. So how do you handle all this? You've got to focus on making value. Another innovation lesson for me: don't focus on making things, focus on making value, focus on compelling customer experiences. You need to understand your customers and innovate and design, engineer, produce, distribute, and service. And I've taken away just a few things that enable you to do this well. The first real key: design innovation to ensure compelling customer experiences. I get asked a lot, why did GM go bankrupt? From my standpoint, we went bankrupt because we took our eye off our total customer experience. We were basically a car designer and manufacturer. Our car was sold through the dealers. And all the other experiences that our customer had to own and operate a car weren't really on our radar screen. And there are just way too many places for our customers to have negative or ambivalent experiences. What you have to be doing here is use your ingenuity to create compelling experiences for your customer. The total experience, the elimination of those negatives, and once you've done that, make your positives even more compelling. You're never done here. This is an ongoing process of always driving toward compelling customer experiences. The second piece is you have to have operational excellence to deliver these consistently positive experiences. You can have the greatest experience design, but if you're not delivering it with super level of quality, reliability, your brand's going to be hurt. I stayed at one of the highest end hotels recently, really a hotel that markets itself around great experience. And when I got to my room, my sink stopper didn't work. The water wouldn't drain out of the sink. Later on, when I came back to my room, my key wouldn't open the door. And you're saying to yourself, my God, this company spent a fortune to design these experiences, market these experiences, and yet the sink stopper and the door key is tainting their brand in my mindset. So you can't walk away from operational experiences. what I'm seeing out there with a lot of the startups in this innovation space called autonomous vehicles are a lot of really brilliant people who've never run an operation. And so those of you who are connected that have that deep operational experience, be thinking about how you use that excellence to participate in this future world. There's a lot of proven best practices. I won't read the list, but what's even more exciting, there's a lot of opportunities to be even better at your operations, and you need to stay on top of those. This is fundamental to making value. The third building block is technology innovation to further enhance customer experiences. So you're never done. You're always innovating around your customer's experience to try to make it better, given what your current technology is. Then there's new technology that you should be creating to give you even greater capabilities. Let me just get this off my screen a second. Even greater capabilities. What's real exciting for me is so much technology is still coming, whether it's information technology or communications or robotics or processes or materials or work systems, analytics or energy. And when you wrap all of that around the system that delivers your customer experience, there's just no end to the kind of innovation that you're going to be able to deliver. I can't emphasize more strongly the plus signs on this diagram. I call that the power of and. It's not going to be any one of these things that becomes important. It's going to be all of these things combining together to deliver new experiences. With that said, you have to be positioning for the future. You don't have any choice. You've got to be thinking big about what's now possible with digital technology and compelling experiences, but you have to start small. You have to learn fast so that you can scale smart. So my advice is you don't need to bet the farm, but you really do need to know how to play your hand. And you need to understand what is the strength of your hand and how does that hand play out in this world of thinking big. It's all about fast learning cycles, which is also really another important innovation lesson. Encourage you to target the tipping point. That's that magic moment when customer value exceeds the market price, so people want it, and the market price exceeds the supplier cost, so companies want to produce it to make money. And for this to happen in my world of autonomous vehicles, the technology has to work, the value has to exist, the regulators must allow it, and society must accept it. These are the things you want to be paying attention to get a read on when you think it's going to tip. These are the things I pay attention to that lead me to conclude this is in a three-year window. And finally, you need to get in front of the inevitable. Think about it. You have two choices. I can position for this future Larry's talking about today sooner, or I can position for it later. If I position for it later and it happens later, I'm prepared. If I position for it sooner and it happens later, I'm prepared early. So maybe I spend a little bit of time and effort sooner than I would have, but I'm still prepared. If I position sooner and it happens sooner, I'm prepared. If I position for later and it happens sooner, I'm toast. And that's the real risk. And quite honestly, I watched the auto industry keep their head in the sand after the DARPA Urban Challenge, probably for about 8 or 9 years before they accepted its inevitability. And they may not have positioned soon enough to stay in this race. So how do you stay in the game? You've got to sustain your operational excellence and you have to be resourceful. While at the same time, you need to be positioning for this future. This new age of automobility, I don't want to oversimplify it for you. There's still an awful lot to learn, a lot to prove, a lot of issues to resolve. But could you be disrupted by the new age of automobility? That's what you have to be thinking about. What if you were a steering wheel manufacturer or an exhaust system manufacturer or an automobile dealer? Or what if you were part of producing and distributing gasoline? I'll tell you have no choice but to do unto yourself before others do unto you. That doesn't mean you're dead in the water, because each of you, if you were in these businesses, have great competencies and great skills. You've been successful in the past. You have to look hard at what it is that got you there and how can I still do those things I'm good at but apply it to this new future. So let me end there. All I can tell you is enjoy the ride. I've enjoyed it. And I've got a new book coming out. HarperCollins is a publisher. It's out in August of 2018. You can actually put the word autonomy and Larry Burns or Lawrence Burns, and you get the Amazon Prime and begin ordering them. But this really tells the, in a very kind of lively storytelling way, almost like a Big Short kind of a novel, the story of how all this came about and what it's going to mean to our future. So let me stop there then, and thank you very much.
Fantastic, Larry. I really appreciate the insight. We have some questions from the attendees. The first one, what will be the first large-scale commercial application of the autonomous vehicle?
I would have answered that 3 or 4 months ago, Harry, as over-the-road trucks. And I still feel very proactive about package delivery. Part of that is when you're delivering a package locally and you don't have a driver in the vehicle, there's no human at risk in that vehicle. Obviously, the other vehicles on the road could be exposed to risk. So, and there's just this real demand for these packages to be delivered. And we know what the economics are of the drivers. We know what they're being paid. And then I put over-the-road trucks into that mix because there's a lot of stretches of the interstate that are straight, nice weather, high traffic, freight movement and stuff. So I see that as being exciting. And I thought that would probably get there before the people movement. But well, I'll tell you, Waymo's made a lot of announcements now. They've become more public about their intent. And John, just this week at the Google I.O. event, John Krafcek indicated they'll be commercializing in the Phoenix area this year. Now, it depends on your definition of high volume. And high volume is important, but for me, it's the tipping point. Will Waymo's efforts this year be sufficient to convince the world that we've hit this tipping point? It's easy to scale this business, quite honestly. Let me just do a little bit of arithmetic for the group. Let's say you want to sell 10% of the miles driven in the United States. That's 300 billion miles a year you want to sell. And you're going to do that in a shared vehicle business model where you're selling 75,000 vehicles per miles per vehicle. That means you need 4 million vehicles operating for a 10% share of the miles. And if those vehicles last 4 years, that means you need to be producing 1 million vehicles a year. 1 million vehicles a year is 1/16th of the annual production in the U.S. So I'll tell you, once this thing's proven and given its profitability potential, there's all kinds of reasons to scale fast. So it can happen pretty fast once you hit that tipping point.
Okay, well, the next question, how will autonomous trucking work with snow on the roads and weather impacting GPS signals?
Well, not real well with snow on the road right now, but the fact is there's an awful lot of opportunity to move freight where snow isn't on the road. And I believe we will solve snow. It's just one of those, another innovation lesson. Don't solve a problem until you need to, as you're working through the opportunity. And so last year I was in Colorado skiing and my flight was canceled from Aspen to Denver. And I had to ride in a van with a bunch of other people late at night over Loveland Pass in a snowstorm. And that's not something that we're going to work on with autonomous vehicles for a while because there's just not that much traffic there. Snow in general will be manageable, and Waymo's doing cold weather testing with their technology. And so the other things you need to be thinking about with over-the-road trucking are traffic. Where do the crashes happen? There are companies, telematics companies out there that have really rich databases. They know where the crashes happen. They know where truck drivers are hitting their brakes hard. They know where truck drivers are swerving with their steering. They know when the truck traffic is stop and go. And they also know stretches of the road where you rarely ever see a crash. So the beauty of this is you can deploy it in a risk-managed way and do the lowest risk opportunities where there's a meaningful amount of freight traffic moving and learn. And then just broaden that envelope year by year and serve more and more of the freight. So it's kind of a nice deployment model, actually.
Yeah. Great. How about the Chinese? The recent announcement to target 20% of electric cars by 2020. How did the Chinese play into this?
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that, Eric, because that's another reason I should have said on that tipping point for electric vehicles. China is really driving EVs, and China is the largest auto market in the world now. So if you're a global auto company, you have no choice but to be in EVs because of China. So why fight it here in the US? Because you're going to be developing these platforms. When I was still at GM leading our R&D, I would wake up in the middle of the night. My biggest fear was the fact that the 25% of the Chinese who are the smartest Chinese people equal the population of the United States. Extraordinarily capable society. And so yes, they're going to play, and they're going to play very big in this space. My presentation is US-centric so far. Waymo's focus has been in the US. That's where I spend my time. But the US doesn't have any corner on this opportunity for any reason at all.
Right, right. Rebecca asked, could you discuss the conflicts between self-driven and autonomously-driven vehicles during the early years? How can they operate in the same city streets?
Well, that was a really important strategic call that Waymo made. There was a whole body of thought at that time that cars needed to talk to each other. That's called vehicle-to-vehicle communication. It needed to communicate with the infrastructure, a traffic light, for example, in order to be able to make them drive themselves. But what that meant is every car had to have that capability before we could deploy these benefits. And Google said, no, we don't want to wait that long. We think we can have a car drive on its own by using digital maps and onboard processors. So that was a really important strategic call. So when the Waymo autonomous vehicle, which is viewed as a level 4 autonomous vehicle, is operating, it's not communicating with another car other than seeing it like you or I would. It's driving like a human would drive. And therefore, because it has 360-degree vision with eyes in the back of its head, and it truly is safer in seeing things and reacting to things, the people in that vehicle are going to be safer, but you're going to be safer because that vehicle's on the road. So Waymo's vehicles will be interacting with human-driven vehicles just fine as we go forward. The real risk are the human drivers. Now, you may have read about a crash here recently where a Waymo car was hit by another car, and it was really an unfortunate situation. Fortunately, while our driver was hurt, she's going to be okay. In this instance, she was driving the car herself in manual mode because it was the end of her period. She's heading back to the depot. And another car ran a red light, and to swerve the car that almost hit it, it went through the median, crossed over to the other lane, and hit the Waymo car. Now, if that was an autonomous vehicle that ran the red light, I don't think that would ever have happened because the autonomous vehicle would have seen the other car coming toward it to hit it, and it would have stopped. It has that redundancy in it. So I really think this is going to be a safer system. It's going to be able to exist together, and we're going to want to get to fully autonomous cars in all cases as soon as possible.
And how about the Uber accident in Arizona where it hit the pedestrian?
Yeah. I'll just help interpret what's been said publicly about that. It's certainly a highly sensitive matter. But the individual who was killed, she was walking her bike from a center median across four lanes, and she was struck by a car in the third lane that she got to. There was plenty of time, Harry, for the sensors to have detected her. That's exactly what these sensors are designed and engineered to do. There was plenty of time for the driver to have seen her. And so something happened there in the software, and unfortunately the driver wasn't engaged enough. But from the analyses I've seen, a human driver in that situation probably would have been able to stop 40 feet short of her. And the autonomous car could have stopped about 120 feet short of her. So something tragic happened there. Okay. I was both that fatality and the Josh Brown fatality with the Tesla autopilot. I've been, I would say, proud of the regulators, proud of the media, and proud of society not to throw the baby out with the bathwater. These things are going to continue to happen, and we have to learn. They're tragic. I feel bad for the families that have been impacted, and we do have to learn off of that. And I truly believe Waymo's car would not have hit the person, which is sad to know.
Yeah. All right. Thanks. Can you share your perspective on which business opportunities which areas or industries have the biggest opportunities?
Well, it's going to be like a lot of transformations. There's going to be a new ecosystem emerge. So the old ecosystem of the old age of the automobile were the car manufacturers, the oil producers, the financiers, the suppliers of parts, the dealers, and all of that. I think you'll see a new ecosystem emerge around this transportation as a service model. And the goal is to provide these great experiences to people riding in their vehicles. And so I think there's all kinds of places to make money. The real question is, will a dominant player emerge that really controls the value creation in that ecosystem? When you think back about personal computers, Microsoft emerged and they created their Windows and everybody had to have it. Every computer manufacturer had to have it, whether they wanted it or not. And Microsoft was in a pretty enviable position. Is it possible that someone can get out there with the world's best driver and really take on that kind of dominant position? And then everybody else is sort of subservient to the person who's, or the company who's sucking most of the profit out of the industry. But what you need is you need the autonomous driving system, and it needs to be put on a vehicle. And then you need to have a place for those vehicles to stage themselves, wait to serve customers. You need to be able to route them. You need to have back office systems like what Uber has for payment and dispatching and all of that. You need to maintain the vehicles. You need to re-energize the vehicles. Uh-huh. You need to do all of those things. So there's going to be a new ecosystem out there. And then the self-driving system will break itself down. But for those of you who may be listening because you're in a sensor business, I think the only way you know how to specify a piece of the self-driving system, let's say it's a LiDAR or a radar or a camera, you've got to specify it at the starting with the total system. The reason Waymo can drive their car the way they do is because it's an integrated system of mapping, lasers, radars, cameras, speed of processing, algorithms, and all of that's changing simultaneously to improve the system. And there's new technology coming into that. So it's real important for people who are looking for a cut of this action to make sure you look at that at the systems level from a specification standpoint.
Sure. So the car rental industry might be well positioned to take advantage of the servicing of fleets, but overall, who do you think is best positioned? Is it the OEM, the car rental, Google, tech firms? Who's going to be servicing and operating the fleets?
You know, what set of companies that don't get a lot of attention are companies who do a lot of that today in the transportation business. There's companies like Keolis and Transdev and others. They're privately held companies, but they operate public transportation systems around the world. So every day they're supplying millions and millions of miles driven by buses and taxis and limos and shuttles and all of that. And they're extraordinary at looking at cost per mile. Their maintenance procedures, how they manage the service parts and how they can tease another 10,000 miles out of a bus or something like that is really to be admired. And they're also extraordinary at understanding the everyday stuff that happens in transportation operations. And they're extraordinary in working with their customers who are oftentimes cities and municipalities. So I think they need to be looked at as well as other companies. I mean, you got to believe the Ubers and Lyfts bring quite a bit of value to this game because they're already serving customers and shared vehicle systems. You've got to believe the FedExes and the UPSs really know how to run their businesses and that they'll be able to integrate autonomous driving into their businesses. In those cases, I think there is a first mover advantage and understanding how much is it worth to make a bold move into autonomous goods distribution. And it's not necessarily inventing the driving system within a major shipper and carrier like a FedEx or UPS, but it's more a matter of, given that it's going to exist, how do I get it integrated? And they've got to manage the social issues because they employ drivers today. And how do they manage their workforce and keep them motivated when the workforce is perceiving that they're working on technology to eliminate their job? In that case, there's a big shortage of drivers, truck drivers. So I think there's a motivation, possibly a win-win here. We need to make the job called truck driver a better job and a more valuable job.
Well, terrific. That ends our hour. We really appreciate all the insights. My Q&A has been blowing up, so I hope it's okay that the attendees are able to contact you maybe with additional questions later. Wonderful. And again, 72 hours from now, we'll send out a link to the recording and thank everyone for participating in this.
Yeah. Thanks for inviting me.
Yeah. Bye. Bye-bye.